days. And now appearing on the main stage, put your hands together and reach deep down in those pockets for Tony Bruno.
That's my next job. I've decided. When I retire here in the next couple of weeks and get out of radio,
I want to be the mic guy.
I want to be the mic guy at the best strip club in America.
Oh, yeah. Shake it, madam. Capital knocker.
Because unlike those guys at strip clubs, I have professional broadcasting skills. When I announce that Cinnamon needs to report to the side stage and Brandy's up on the main stage, I'll at least make it sound professional. I won't sound like some yut DJ who just got fired because the station went to the jack format and now all these DJs are out of work.
Cinnamon, please report to the DJ booth and Destiny to the side stage.
Man, you are one pathetic loser.
Yeah, exactly. That is you, loser.
And now, Tony Bruno.
Dodgers, Cardinals, Rockies, Devil Rays, and Mariners did the weekend baseball interleague play sweeps. And Bobby Abreu finally hit a home run. Do we have the tape of Bobby Abreu?
Is that his first home run since the home run derby?
I think this is the first home run since he came over to this country from the Dominican or Venezuela, wherever he's from. I think it's the first one since the World Baseball Classic. No, it's been a while. I think April 19th. Let's go to Jim. He knows. When was the last time Bobby Abreu hit a home run, Jim? Before yesterday, of course.
Tony, I think it was April 21st.
April 21st.
Yeah. Well, today I have audio. You're talking about PA announcers last week.
We had the great Mason on from Detroit, and Laker fans called up because they like the boring and in nondescript Lawrence Tanter.
Well, we have Dave Zinkoff back. Two small clips of Dave Zinkoff.
Oh, the greatest PA man in the history of sports, Dave Zinkoff.
One clip is when he welcomed everybody to the old Spectrum, and the other one's with Dr. J.
Oh, let's go to the tape. That's the greatest public address announcer in their history. No one, with all due respect to Mason,
and Lawrence Tanter,
and all of these other guys, they will never be anybody else is a cheap imitator and a wannabe. That guy was the greatest of all time because no one was like him before then, and no one will be like him ever again. Right, Jim? Jim Lee? He hung up. After Dr. J. Julius, he was phenomenal.
I'm going to take that as a disagreement with the statement.
And Dave Zinkoff was this little guy, an older gentleman, short, nondescript guy, but when he got behind the mic, he was phenomenal. The greatest PA. And he's in the Hall of Fame. The only public address announcer, as far as I'm concerned, or I can remember. I don't know about baseball. And probably, what's his name, Bob Shepard. The Yankee voice at Yankee Stadium for a gazillion years. I don't know if he's in the Baseball Hall of Fame, but he will be if he's not. Dave Zinkoff is in the Basketball Hall of Fame. That's how good he was. Phenomenal. Ladies and gentlemen, a lot of people reacting to the Dave Zinkoff sound effect. Not sound effect, some of the clips from Jim in Philly. He's the best. We had Mason on last week, the PA guy in Detroit for the Pistons. Unbelievable reaction. People love PA guys. Not Pennsylvania guys. They love me, of course. I'm a PA guy. But Dave Zinkoff bringing back a lot of memories, getting emails from all over the world, people saying thanks for doing that. I want to thank Jim. He's got all the clips. Dave Zinkoff was the greatest. I got goosebumps listening to that because I was there when he was doing that stuff. Let's go to Marie, who was trying to find a picture of me.
You know what?
Why, Marie?
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning. I'm on the internet. I'm a senior citizen, and I listen to you every day.
Well, thank you,
Marie. And I just think you're adorable. But I'm trying to find a picture of you because I just everybody says you're such a stud.
Really?
Know? Well, yeah, I guess. You know, you talk about all your.
Now you sound like a very young and vibrant woman. How old are you, Marie?
75.
That's young and vibrant.
Thank you. Well, ladies need love too, you know.
You know what they say about them older women?
Uh-huh. Try
they
it out,
keep,
baby.
They
try
keep
it
getting
out.
The... They...
Gotta get down with the old ladies, baby. Gotta get down with the old ladies.
They may not stay the same age, but who cares?
Right, there's right, no right, way you're 75, Marie.
That's right, boy. I mean...
Well, all right, what year were you born?
1932.
Is that 75?
Yes, it is.
1932.
Wow.
I can't call Gary Raderich because he doesn't like old people. He's going to call his show, so screw him.
Exactly right.
Yeah, seriously, you know, he's always saying, give me your age, blah, blah, blah. Well, who the hell does he think he is?
Exactly right.
Jeez, you know. Got
so you're
it.
Up there in Santa Rosa where the living is good. That's why.
Right. Oh, yeah, near Joe Montana out there by... Mark Springs West Road. I heard you talk about him or something. He's up somewhere, Bozeman or Bozeman. Or
Bozeman, Montana.
Bozeman, Montana, yeah. Right,
now, Marie, right. No, you can go up. My pictures are all over the Internet.
Well, I'm trying to... I'm in SportingNews.com, and all it says is, call Tony at this number. And I thought, what have I got to
well,
lose?
Well, that's a good start. Now, go to Sporting News, and then there's a radio link on there.
Yeah, go to SportingNewsRadio.com.
Or, no, if you go just to SportingNews.com, yeah, there's a radio link. Click on that, and then you can
wait,
see
wait
my
a
picture.
Minute, baby. You're going too fast.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm too old here.
Yeah, that's
I
why,
love the baby talk,
that's
though. I've never had...
I'm rolling down this thing here, you know. I just bought this thing, and my God, what a thing.
Is this
oh,
your
there
first?
You are?
Yes.
Oh, my God, you're darling. Look at that head. My God. How cute. Is that too much?
Oh, my God.
I love it. Oh my God, you've made my life. I can't
see and you have to thank for that, Marie. Thank Al Gore for inventing the internet.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for Al Gore and his technology and
oh,
the people
please.
And digital cameras,
oh,
don't forget those.
And this and that, he doesn't know his
and by the way, the that picture is not even that's not airbrushed, that's not Photoshop. I have a pimple on my head. It's like that's the natural me.
That's you, baby. Oh my God. How do I get a big picture like that? How do I make it big?
Oh my God.
I mean I got to have that.
Well, leave your address and leave us. So we'll send you one. I'll have to find one. I have the same picture in color. We can send you one, Marie. How's
send
that?
Send Marie an autographed picture,
are
for God's sake.
Are you serious?
Yes, I'm serious.
Oh, and you know the fella that works with it just got married recently.
That's that Mark Willard guy?
That's
yeah.
Marie. Yes,
Mark,
how are you?
He's very sweet, too. Everybody picks on him.
No,
and
they
you know
well,
what?
Tommy
Lasorda, that old turd. You know, I met him years ago, and he's still the same. He don't know what.
Marie, I couldn't have a bigger crush on you right now. Let me tell you that right now. No, don't worry about people picking on me. One, that's what I'm here for, and
well,
two... As a Bay Area kid, having Tommy Lasorda not like you, not such a bad thing. You know?
By the way, did you hear what Tommy Lasorda, he just heard what you said, Marie, and he doesn't particularly
you know
care, he said something.
You'll tell Tommy Lasorda. Goodbye.
I enjoy talking to you.
Tommy Lasorda. Good Lord. I knew him when Buzzy Bacy was his manager, for crying out loud.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, go way back, honey, way back.
Way back.
The original groupie.
Are you the original groupie?
You got it, baby.
I'm one of the original, what's the OGs? I'm one of the OGs.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
original gangster. Yeah,
original
that's him, Marie.
How cute you are. Look at those eyes.
Marie, stop it now. You're making me blush.
Do you still have that thing around your mouth, that hair?
Yes, I do.
Oh, my God.
Yes,
and you've got a French girlfriend, too, huh?
Yes, I do.
Get
wow.
down, baby. Get down. Oh, God. What a thrill to talk to you guys.
Well, thanks, Marie. You should come down and do limoncello shots with us next week.
Oh,
yes.
Please. You know, I had to laugh so hard with you and those limoncellos or whatever you call them. And listen to that laugh. Is that the cutest thing?
You're a very delightful woman, Marie. Thank you very much. We know next week, you got to call us back. We'll get your address. We'll send you one of those beautiful headshots that we have here, if we can find any. We'll take care of you.
Best Christmas present I'll ever get, because, you know, I have nobody. You know, I'm all by myself. I have no children or nothing. And I just, that'll be my best Christmas present.
Well, thank you, Marie. Hang on, we'll get your information. Thanks so much for calling, and you're very delightful. How nice is she?
Wow.
Can you believe that?
She goes straight to the top of the line, Tony.
Exactly right.
I'm the manager.
No.
Yes.
I mean, first of all, if it takes more than 5 minutes for her to be your top friend on MySpace, something's wrong.
We need to get Maria on MySpace.
Second of all, she called Tommy Lasorda a turd.
I know.
Wow.
If Tommy heard that, or he were on the line with that lovely woman, Marie.
I've never been more jealous of anyone in my entire life.
You know what he would say to her probably at this time?
I don't particularly like it.
Thank you, Tommy.
You're having a good time at somebody's expense.
You're darn right we are.
Not me.
Oh, man.
Not me.
You paid like $30 million when you get suspended.
Do we have a 10-second clip from the promotion we were recording during the breaks? Country, we have a tape. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. This is Tony Bruno. Now you can listen to my... I sound like Dick Vermeil.
What is the damn line?
I don't know what the damn line is. I'm trying to read it. Stop laughing. Don't be laughing at this There you have it. That's the kind of stuff we do during the breaks here.
That is Tony Bruno Unplugged, coming out on CD for the holidays.
Because I'm taping liners for our affiliates. And, and I mess them up. I mean, I usually do one take. I'm good. I'm a one-take guy.
Kind of like Chumbawamba was.
But then you give me like a 15 minutes and I can be a two-take guy. And then I record the thing and there was one mistake that I made and Country plays a drop-in during my mess-up and then I say a bad word and now I look like a bad guy. Am I going to be suspended by Roger Goodell, the NFL commissioner, today?
Depends. Are you going to go next door and spit in Country's face right now?
Colts tonight minus the 3. Mr. Monday Night said it's a stone-cold lock, Mark Willard.
Lock. Colts. Colts by, I don't know, at least 4.
That's a lock.
Sporting News Radio. Sporting News Radio.
February 5th, 2007. There is no Super Bowl shuffling in Chicago because, in the immortal words of Rex Grossman,
it is what it is.
Grossman is back to throw here on first down and lost one. Now the right side hit off a bad pass that is intercepted and being returned by Hayden down the sideline, down to the 20, down to the 10, 5, touchdown.
Manning's monkey is finally dead and buried as the Colts capture the NFL crown. And Bruno's in Miami to break it all down.
And that's what I'm talking about.
Guests of the Tony Bruno Show are brought to you by StubHub. StubHub, where fans buy and sell tickets. And now, live in Miami, here's Tony Bruno.
There's only one guy who's got my temperature boiling right now. He comes in here and he starts getting into an argument with me. Now we've saved it for the air. Sal Palantonio of ESPN, who obviously did not watch the same game that I watched. He joins us right now, live here in Miami. Sal, are you on crack or what, man?
Well, first of all, I don't talk to people with Seattle Seahawks hats
on. Hey, slow down, partner.
Slow down.
Take a step back.
What is that?
I lived in Seattle for 20 years.
Oh, good God.
I'm flying the flag, buddy. I'm flying the flag.
With the Seahawks
I'm representing here. Come on, buddy.
What kind of joke is that?
What do you want me to wear? An Eagles hat? I didn't even notice it. I didn't even notice that.
Now I know you're on crack.
What do you want me to do? Wear an Eagle? What should I be wearing?
You don't know the guy's hats.
What should I be wearing?
I don't wear teams' hats, especially the Seahawks.
Oh, for the love of God. Who was in the Super Bowl last year? Was it the Eagles or the Seahawks?
Good God.
Yeah. All right, Sal, we had a dispute. Sal sits down and says the first thing, the Colts lost the game. No, the Bears lost the game. The Colts didn't win the game. Is that what you said?
The Colts didn't win the game. The Bears lost the game.
The Colts did not. Well, let me repeat. Sal Palantonio says the Bears lost the game. The Colts didn't win it. Sal, did you look at the final stats of this game by any chance?
I did look at
did
the final stats.
Did you watch the game by any chance?
Would you like me to explain, or are you going to try to interrogate me?
No, go ahead. You have the last one. I'll give you the last one.
Who was winning the game? The Chicago Bears were winning the game,
They were winning the game 14 seconds on the first kickoff.
Yeah, and then they gash them with Thomas Jones up the middle that sets up the Musi Muhammad touchdown pass. They're up 14-6.
Correct.
Then they stop running the football. They hand it to their worst offensive player. They have a pass run ratio in the game of 59 to 40%. 60-40 pass run ratio. Their worst player. Why did they stop running the ball? They had no contingency plan for the sloppy weather. Rex Grossman, the bad Rex, he emerges from the slop like the Loch Ness Monster, for crying out loud.
All right,
and so you hand it to him. and he just gives the game away. I mean,
but wasn't Cedric Benson on the sideline with a bad knee?
Yeah, he was. So why did they take Thomas Jones? Their O-line, in the middle of their O-line, averages 300 pounds. They know the Colts have a smallish defensive front. The history of the entire season, except for the last couple of games, is you can run up the middle against the Colts, okay? And they did that with that long run. It sets up the Muhammad pass. It's 14-6. Give me the running plays after the touchdown pass, Mr. Seahawk.
After the touchdown pass. The next running play was a Cedric Benson fumble.
Yeah, okay. And then after that?
Then after that, that was the end of the first quarter.
That was the play Cedric Benson was hurt on the fumble, right?
Yeah, fumble, right?
All right. So the next time, they go Thomas Jones up the middle, 4 yards. Thomas Jones left, no gain.
Yep.
Then Rex Grossman short pass to Rashid Davis for 2 yards, and then they punted the ball. Then their next possession, short pass to Thomas Jones. Short run up the middle by Jason McKee. Thomas Jones right tackle for 2 yards.
Yep. You got to give the Colts defense
the Colts
credit
actually
here.
Were stopping
I mean,
guys
out.
Give the Colts their defense some credit.
Yeah,
man.
The defense played well.
I mean, one play.
You know, the people listening in Indianapolis now, you send your hate mail to Sal Palantonio at ESPN, not to me. See, I like to give the teams credit. I'm not doing. You like to do the Phil Jackson that the other team didn't win it. We gave it to them. The Bears were still in this game, even though they were being completely dominated statistically. They had two plays in this game, the Bears, Sal. Two plays.
Yeah.
Other than that, they couldn't do anything. They couldn't run, you're right. And the Colts' defense was laying people out, man.
They stopped running.
You think if they kept running the ball, they would have won.
They needed to keep Peyton Manning. How many plays did the Colts run?
Like 63 to
23. How about 82?
I know. At one point, it was 63 to 23.
82 plays they ran in the game. You know, the NFL average is 71. They ran 82 plays in that football game. If the Bears had run the football more in the second half and kept Peyton Manning off the field, what was the score in the middle of the third quarter? They were up by two.
And it was five. Then it was five. And the Bears weren't the Colts
had,
were not punching
the ball
in. The Bears defense is good, but you got to if you're going to rip Rex Grossman, how about the Bear defense? Peyton Manning was picking him apart. Urlacher was playing 10 yards back, and then Peyton was throwing it six yards, and guys were picking up chunks
at
a time.
The defense was playing exactly like the Patriots had played in the past. Bend, don't break. Don't give any deep balls up. Excuse me. Keep him out of the end zone, in the red zone, and they were doing that. But the offense wasn't helping them because they couldn't control the line of scrimmage.
Exactly.
They couldn't control the ball.
And the Colts kept the ball by moving the ball up and down the field. The time of possession and number of plays kept the Bears off the field. And every time Rex Grossman went back on the field, he didn't know what to do with it. He had to punt. He wasn't making plays, Sal, and neither were the running backs. The Bears had no offense in the second half of this game. None.
Yeah,
they did nothing.
The Colts defense was missing not only Nick Harper, but Marlon Jackson, okay? They're starting left corner and their backup left corner, okay? So what does Rex Grossman do? He throws a punt, basically, to Kelvin Hayton, the third string corner, who returns it for a touchdown. I mean, how bad is that?
Another one to Bob Sanders playing center field out there.
And that was Rex Grossman at the end, showing you that he's not ready to be a guy who's got a chance to come back and win a Super Bowl because he's not good enough
yet.
I'm
just ticked off because he's got that stupid Seahawks hat on.
Get the Sea hat off, Bob Stell.
Not a chance in hell, buddy.
I did not even know he had that Seahawks hat on until
that's
you
told
right,
me. I'm flying the flag.
And his head's way up above me, and I can't see. I'm going to look it up saying, hey, what's
there
that?
It is.
Oh, it's that
there
puffy
it
Seahawk thing.
There it is,
one of
right
puffy,
there.
Puffy, puffy, yummy,
listen,
things.
Just give the Colts defense a little love.
Yeah, how about giving somebody
just give the defense a little love.
I think they played well. There's no question about it.
You know, people in Indianapolis now are cursing at you right now, Sal.
But the Bears' offense played right into their hands. They didn't have a contingency plan for the bad weather. By the way,
don't they play in Chicago?
This was the worst Super Bowl ever.
It was?
Come on, the Giants and the Ravens.
No, this was the worst Super Bowl.
Sal, I remember we were sitting in the Georgia Dome in Atlanta
for the
Titans and the Rams, and it was
Super
an
Bowl.
Awful first half. Remember that Titans-Rams game?
Brilliant.
You and I
half.
Are up in the upper deck in the Georgia Dome, and you said to me at that time, this is the worst Super Bowl ever. You say that every year?
It turned into a great one. That was the worst Super Bowl ever. It's too bad that the weather played such a big part in the game, and the weather was just, it killed people out in the stands. It was horrible.
It was. I agree.
It was a horrible, horrible situation.
I totally agree, but both teams had a play in it.
Yeah. No. I'm just saying.
And give the Dome team some credit for going outside in weather and playing better than the team is supposed to play in weather.
I don't know what Lovie Smith was doing. I don't know what Ron Turner was doing, but they just played right into the hands of the Colts.
They forced them to. They got out-coached.
Well, they did. They got out-coached.
The Colts forced them to play the way they did. You got to give the Colts some credit here for for this?
I said I'm giving him some credit, but I'm saying the biggest issue that I see is the Bears had the lead and gave it away.
But that happens in all Super Bowls, though. You're up 10 points, that doesn't mean anything unless it's the fourth quarter where nobody comes back. But, you know, when the Colts took the lead, can you say, oh, you know, the Colts could have given the lead right back if the Bears were able to do anything? They weren't,
and
because
it's the
Colts
Super Bowl
defense
I would have made
well.
A change of quarterback. I would have pulled them.
You'd have put Greasy in there?
I would have put Greasy in there.
Really?
You would have done something to spark the offense. You got it's the Super Bowl,
but
man.
They were only down by
they
were down.
They couldn't make a play. You just told me they couldn't make a play.
They couldn't make a play, but it wasn't like they were getting their brains beaten in here.
They were five with the ball.
They were within a score.
They were down five with the ball, and Rex Grossman couldn't get it done. You think Brian Greasy is just going
to
go in there and if he pulls if Lovie Smith pulls Rex Grossman in that part,
he's finished.
He can't even bring him back next year.
He's finished.
What are you, crazy, Sal?
Who says he should bring him back next year?
The Colts beat the Patriots, or do the Patriots lose that one?
This is the beauty about being on the radio with Tony Bruno. Your career is blown up.
I am going to
need like 4 months to recover from this conversation.
The damage is done from this one.
Yeah, the damage is done. They're recording this in Bristol, Connecticut. What are you doing going on with that bald-headed geek on crack?
They love me in Bristol.
Where's the crack, man?
Everybody. All those people at ESPN still love me. Come on.
Do they?
You're not allowed to come on, Sal?
I'll find out shortly.
They shouldn't allow you on ESPN after you said the stuff you just said.
Your producer comes over and says, Tony Bruno wants you on the air. Hey, it's a wonderful elixir. I've got to go. It's like looking into the sun. You can't stop.
Let me ask
Thanks
you this.
A lot, Sal.
After the game, I was watching Sal. They were playing his interview.
Why were you watching him?
He happened to pop up on TV.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he was dripping wet, water running down his face.
Were you wet, Sal? He's more wet now. He just dropped water on his
tie. Yeah, he was soaked. He was soaked. But he was talking to Peyton Manning, and I actually saw joy on the face of Sal Palantoni. He actually looked. You looked genuinely happy.
Do you not feel good for him? Yeah, how can you not feel good for Peyton and Tony and those guys?
Even in the way you said, "Hey, Peyton, congratulations." It seemed like you were really, really feeling it.
Yeah, because I think he's been maligned. Unfairly. I mean, the guy's a class act, and there are people out there who just don't like him because they believe he's overexposed himself in commercials. And, you know, I've always just liked him, and I've liked the Manning family. I think they're just warm-hearted people, and if there's anybody who deserves to get the monkey off their back, it's Peyton Manning. And, you know, Tony Dungy has obviously made history. It's Black History Month. He's the first African-American head coach to win the Super Bowl, but he's just a decent human being, a great leader. He's done it his way. You don't need an egomaniac. You don't need an irascible guy who is going to treat everybody around them like they're automatons, like they're androids, like some people that we know. Coaches who shall remain nameless. Dungy treats people with respect.
Are you ripping Bill Belichick?
I said nameless.
Okay, you mean Bill Belichick.
I'll name him.
Tony Dungy treats people with respect, and he's done it his way, and he's got a loyal following of players and people in the media for good reason.
Yeah, and having said all that, he doesn't want to give the Colts credit.
By the way, I just got this email. Dear Tony, after listening to Sal Palantoni, I'm beginning to wonder who has more football knowledge. Sal, Prince, Katie Couric, or David Spade? Really Colts fan.
By the way, what was with Prince yesterday with that do-rag he was wearing on his head? He looked like, I don't know, it's like...
He had a do-rag on because he's got the process. You know, back in the day when he grew up in the streets, you put the rag and got the process
on.
What is
with
that do-rag? And he ripped it off through...
Are you all right, Sal? You okay?
That's okay.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Did you like the halftime show? Did you think it was good?
I thought it was horrible. Here's the thing.
Doesn't like anything, Sal. This guy said it was the greatest halftime show I've ever seen. Sal's calling this the worst Super Bowl.
He's a bitter, broken man, this guy.
No, I'm not.
You don't even bet, right? Let me make it clear.
You don't bet
on the game, and you didn't pick the Bears on the air, right?
I picked the Colts on ESPN.com.
Okay.
I picked them to win by 11. They won by
4. Because you sound like a bitter, broken... You know what I mean?
People will say, does this guy bet and lose the bet? I picked them to win by 11, and they won by 12. But here's a memo to Roger Goodell. Every halftime show, you ought to be able to sing along with... You know, just sing along. Understand maybe two or three words. That would take that.
You have power. Go talk to the commissioner, who, by the way, did say players who flunk NFL substance abuse tests next year will be banned from the Pro Bowl.
What about radio talk show hosts?
I've already been banned. I'm the only guy here.
Are we being tested?
Sal Palantoni, you know him, you hate him, but he hates everything, too. He's like Mikey.
He doesn't like anything. Remember Mikey from the what was the cereal?
Life cereal.
Life cereal. Here's Sal Palatino. He hates everything. Sal, good to see you, man.
Hey, will you autograph that hat for me?
No. Absolutely. Get out of here. Quarter to the hour. Dear Tony, you couldn't live on half of your salary? How much was that Moroccan bench? Sincerely, the guy at the city dump will help you pick out the cinder blocks. We were talking earlier about Larry Brown getting paid $18.5 million as a settlement for coaching the Knicks for 1 year. Basically, $27.5 million for 1 year work. Even Savannah Sampson doesn't make that, even with her wine and everything else.
Close.
No, Vivid doesn't quite pay me that much yet.
Savannah Sampson here in studio. She's going to make stone cold locks. So all you guys out there desperate, well, you're listening anyway. If you're desperate for winners, Savannah's got those too. I'm just desperate for Savannah. I even learned, I showed her the technique I learned from the sport chicks in Tampa on how to properly pull a woman's hair. Is that the right way? Because a woman knows how to please another woman better than a man. I learned that a long time ago when I was 17 years old, living with two 30-year-old women. But I didn't learn the hair pull thing until recently. But I'm always willing to learn.
You just taught it to me now.
Yeah, that's the good thing about me. I'm older, but I don't think I know it all, and I'm always willing to learn new techniques.
So,
you know what I mean, Mark?
Yeah, I can't.
You should learn.
I can't use that technique on you, though.
No, but you can still grab the back of my neck like that.
There you go.
That's kind of weird, though, isn't it?
No, to learn how to properly pull a woman's hair. I didn't shave my head, though. It's like a woman who doesn't shave her legs. Like the girl in Tampa at the bar. What was her name?
Not quite like that, though.
Was that woman's name at the
bar? Morgan Stone?
Morgan Stone didn't shave her legs, and then like girls were feeling it, and she had the little stubble thing.
Oh, poor thing. She was embarrassed. I'll tell you what, I'm going through that hair removal procedure.
The laser one? The laser one?
It hurts so badly, yes.
Viv got that done, the laser thing.
I just have one more treatment.
Good. One more treatment?
Yep. And I never thought I'd use my Vivid positions as much as trying to get in there with the laser thing. You
know? Wait, I got an email for Savannah here.
Not helpful to you?
Email tony@sportingnews.com. Dear Savannah, you can come by my place and have all the sushi you can eat. Yum. Sincerely, Cousin Stevie. So you got to be you knew who's Cousin Stevie.
I know Cousin Stevie.
I think that's the one this person is. It's not really Cousin Stevie. It's somebody pretending to be.
Oh.
You know Cousin Stevie is, right?
Yes.
Are we going to make the football picks? Should we do those now?
Should we do it now?
Ladies and gentlemen, actor award-winning. How many AVN awards is Actress of the Year?
I won 2 AVN awards for Best Actress. And I won 2 consecutive years in a row, Best Girl-Girl Scene with Jenna Jameson.
Of course. Dominant.
Yeah, absolutely. Both of us. For 2 years. For
that was
the
my lock of the year.
And for the masseuse. When I
pick the AVN Awards, because we pick on everything on the show, we pick Dancing with the Stars. It just doesn't just sports. I predicted you would win.
You did
the AVN Awards.
Well, if you saw my movies, then you would know that I should win.
I got Where the Boys Aren't, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18. Is there a 19 yet?
You know, I've lost track. Well, because we filmed 2 at once.
Really?
Yes.
I hate when they do that. Didn't they just do that with...
confusing.
They did that with Pirates of the Caribbean, didn't they?
Star Wars, they can do it with Savannah, can't they?
Wait a minute. When you do Where the Boys Aren't, 16 and 17, you do 2 at the same time?
Yes. Well, actually, I do, like, how many Vivica? Like 9 at the same time.
I'm saying. Do 2 at the same time in every movie, right?
If I'm lucky.
Oh, my. Dear Tony, thank you for the slump buster. We wouldn't get this on ESPN Radio. You are the best. Sincerely, David, listening in Minneapolis. Of course, they
you
wouldn't do this.
You are the best.
Thank you, sir.
Tony Bruno.
Thank you. Are you ready for the picks? Now, let's put the music back on here, country.
Yeah, once the music goes, you're supposed to make the picks. We just kind of rolled right through
it. It is time, ladies and gentlemen. Award-winning actress, bon vivant, raconteur, wine connoisseur, and the greatness that is Savannah Sampson.
And we're getting everybody out of the slump right now. You ready?
Oh, man, do I need it so bad.
Okay. Well, Tony, Joe Pa may be laid up in bed this weekend, but I'll be the one laying the points.
Beautiful.
Let's start along the turnpike. All of those cars will be coming and going and coming, and Louisville will be going right down the field, scoring again and again and again. Take Louisville and lay the points. It's the most fun you can have on a Thursday night.
Give her a lock right there. Give her the symbol and then the sound there, country. That's not the most fun I can have on a Thursday night, but you're leaving town. What time are you leaving tonight?
4-ish.
Oh!
What's
I'll be on the plane.
Can you take a later flight?
I think I probably will have to end up taking a later flight. Now, I know that Mark is the Mac Daddy and the Daddy Mac.
Right.
But I'm not going to make the jump. I'll pass on the stinking Buffalo game.
That's right, Mark. Mark earlier took Buffalo over Akron tonight. Or Buffalo with the points.
You can win money in that one, too.
Savannah saw that one coming a mile away. She is not going to touch that one.
No.
What about Saturday, Savannah?
On Saturday, the old ball coach returns to the swamp, and I like the way he manages the clock. I love the South Carolina Gamecocks. Take them to cover. And finally...
You got an NFL pick?
I do. My one NFL selection finds us Cincinnati. I know the Chargers like to pound the ball with LT, but I like the way that the Bengals come from behind.
They're not complaining and arguing with each other. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. She's taking the Bengals with the points. She's taking the South Carolina to cover.
Mm-hmm.
She's not touching the stinking Mac game tonight.
Right. No.
And she likes Louisville.
Laying the lumber tonight with Louisville. We are also going with Louisville tonight.
Yes,
laying the
did.
6.5. It's not that we hate Rutgers, even though you don't live too far away from Rutgers on the Garden State Parkway in New Jersey.
Yeah, that's right.
But you got to take. You know, you got to take Louisville tonight.
Yes.
Savannah, and you got to take my offer up to come over tonight. You got to come by the house, seriously. Why do you not want to come by my house?
I want to
I'm
come.
Not
you
anything.
Just invited me right now.
Are you coming over?
Yeah, I'll come over.
I'm right near you. I'm literally, you can look out my patio and see where you are from my house.
Oh, so maybe you can see me in my window and I'll be flashing. You know I like to do that.
I don't have, you can flash right from my patio if you'd like. And then more people will see you because I'm only on the second floor. What floor are you on, by the way?
I'm on the third floor. Well, it's much higher than that. But yeah, third floor.
Yeah, I'm good. I'm glad you're not on the seventh floor because you get in trouble over there. If you're Let me say this right now. Listen to me and listen to me good.
What?
I feel different.
Tony Bruno.
It's summertime.
Ever since I've been working with Craig Larson, I get sick like he does every single day now. I'm always sick. It's over.
Are you okay?
Why? Where's the love, Mark Weller? That's what I get for getting a massage with a woman who's sneezing the entire hour.
We did try to talk you out of that, but I was still on your side on that, Tony. I mean, how are you to know that the masseuse was going to be sick and sneeze on you?
Ridiculous.
Not very good masseuse behavior.
And now, here's Tony Bruno.
You're off beat there, Mark Weather.
No, I'm not.
You messed me up.
No, I was perfect. I had it. I had it going.
Enough my wife out with two fingers. You just have to pay for that. Friday, June 22nd. Interleague baseball. Yankees and Giants and Phillies and, well, that's not an interleague. Phillies and Cardinals is an actual National League matchup.
Right, there's always got to be one National League matchup.
There's always got to be one series that messes up interleague play. Like Pittsburgh and the Angels. Isn't that the series this weekend?
Yes, it is.
Whenever the Pittsburgh Pirates come to Anaheim, you throw away the record books, you throw away the programs, and you throw away anything that's not sold to the concession stand.
Yeah, everybody else talks about Boston and the Padres, Cubs and the White Sox, the Tigers play the Braves.
Yep.
This weekend, the Giants and the Yankees. We like to point out the other interleague series that are out there. The Angels and the Pirates. The Royals and the Brewers. The Orioles and the Diamondbacks who will be getting together for three.
That's beautiful, man. You know, before I retire, I have to put together the best of Tony outtake reels. I don't have any of them, though. Every place I've worked, they always put outtake reels with me together. with some of my most profane and profound moments.
Well, now we just do them on the air.
Yeah, but yeah, no, there's the good stuff. There's actually good stuff off the air, too. Actually, the show that goes on between the show. We should air that, like, on satellite. Well, we're on XM Satellite Radio.
Remember one day we did air that on the Internet.
Yeah, we're on the Internet. Yeah. People were listening on the down the line. For those of you listening down the line, you get the extra juicy version.
Boy, in today's day and age, how you didn't get fired over that, I have no idea.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm one of those. I'm like Teflon Don.
You are.
Do we have some tape in their country that it can get me fired? No, don't play it on the air. Come on.
You're always ripping USC for being a Teflon program. You are the Teflon radio host.
I don't do it on the air. I do it during, like, recording sessions.
Right.
Do we have one? We have tape? Oh, this is one. We were in San Francisco.
This is the one we aired live on the
KNVR,
Internet.
At KNVR. And then during the breaks.
Unbeknownst to us.
Our mics were still on, but we weren't on the air. But the programming was still being played down the line so that people listening on the Internet could hear what we were saying during the breaks. Do we have tape?
What are we 31 to 10, your chips.
31 to 10. That was all that in a bag of chips. It was easy. That quarterback at Central Michigan is really good.
Unbelievable, man. Listen, we were drinking one of the two bottles of wine before the Filipina chicks came in.
And you both of them?
Of course.
Okay.
So I roll.
Boy, that was early in the morning.
The nation would be proud.
I said, what do you have in front of you? Do you have, like, a computer or whatever?
I have a computer. There's a call screen, okay. Obviously, but it's not working.
Obviously, you know Russell Bay is tied yesterday.
Yes, he did.
There's this kid in Wisconsin, a cornerback that has been arrested for trying to steal an Xbox.
No way.
Yeah.
You can tell that was early. I think that was like the first segment we were talking to. Mark was here.
That's
right. Mark wasn't in. I was in San Francisco. Mark was here in L.A.
Not invited.
And so we were. Well, you were invited.
No, actually, I wasn't.
Financial thing. Yeah, it was more of a cost cutting.
I know.
And so we're talking to each other down the line during the breaks. I was pretty much wasted that morning.
Well, yeah.
I wasn't wasted. I had a long night.
You had been wasted at a previous hour.
I don't normally sound that half asleep when I'm. Because I get up and I'm boom, I'm going.
My voices were even deeper at that point.
Yeah, because women were listening.
Well, no.
We always do that when women are.
Most guys' voices go up when they talk to a woman on the phone.
No, not me.
No, not you.
I learned from the old Barry White school. When you have a chick on the phone, the voice goes down a couple of octaves. Hey, baby. We got it together, baby, don't we? You know what I'm talking about.
You've never said to a girl, we got it together.
Yes,
now,
I have.
David, do you?
Of course.
Really?
It worked for me. It was like 80s, though. I don't know if that works anymore.
It was so 80s, actually, Tony, that line. But.
Myers has the sign from West Coast. Curveball struck it out. The Phillies are National Ladies Champions. They're the seed on the field.
Harry Gallard with a call. Pandemonium. And the Phillies win. The Mets collapse is complete. And you know what, Mark? Well, to show you what a guy I am, I'm more happy about the positive part, the Phillies winning. You haven't heard me once this morning say, how does it feel, Mets fans? Did I do that one time?
Oh, I've kind of been waiting, actually.
I know. I almost feel bad for Willie Randolph.
What? No.
I don't feel bad for Billy Wagner because he's a jerk and he can't pitch and the Mets overpaid him.
This is New York and all the money and being there the last few years. And the Mets, don't feel sorry for them.
I don't. You're right. How does it feel?
There you go.
How does it feel, Mets fans?
That's why I don't read the newspaper.
Damn right.
God, I thought that you were actually suddenly a California guy.
No, never.
Be a mean Philly guy again.
I will.
Okay.
When we go to Philly for the Dallas Cowboys.
Now and every day. Be a mean Philly guy.
I can't. I got my Phillies jersey on. I'm happy, happy, happy today. I'm like Pete Happy. I'm Tony Feliz. Tony Happy. How can you not be happy?
I'm happy.
The Eagles' stink-out performance against the Giants didn't get me down last night. I didn't yell once. Well, I did at Winston Justice when I said, hey, how about blocking him one time?
Sporting News Radio. The Tony Bruno
Bruno Show.
Let's go to Keith. Oh, wait a minute.
Hello?
Keith, what are you got going on there?
Oh, come man, on. I'm over here. I believe this man getting some Mickey D's breakfast, man.
Doesn't sound like a happy meal to me, Keith.
Yeah, what's going on there? Who's in there yelling at you?
Oh, man, you know, they got little money issues here, man. You can't pull out big bills in the morning.
Oh, that's the employees at McDonald's yelling at you? I thought you were at home and your wife was yelling at you.
You must have gone special order on them again. God, they hate it when you do that.
I want a hamburger. No, cheese. I want a hot dog. I want a milkshake.
You guys are tripping in the morning with this money.
Exactly right, man. And you tell those people, you're the customer. They don't yell at you. You yell at them.
Please come again.
And now, here's Tony Bruno.
Let's go to Mr. C, who's going to get some bad news from me right now. Good morning, sir.
Hello there, Anthony. It is Judgment Day, and there's no doubt about that. I'm rolling through Button Willow as we speak.
Oh, I love Button Willow. You got to stop at that little K's Kitchen restaurant or whatever it's called, Mr. C.
You mean the House of India, the little House of India?
Now, for those people on most of 99% of the planet, and I've been to Palm Springs, California, a gazillion times, where is Button Willow on the way to Palm Springs?
Button Willow is right before the Grapevine on Highway 5, right before you go through the mountain. So, in other words, it's maybe north of Magic Mountain by what? Half hour, Mr. C?
Yeah, it's the Mac Daddy of Slaughterhouse.
There you go.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah.
Well, Mr. C, wait, I'm going to have you call me back, sir. I hate to do that to you because I know you've been on hold, but we have a special guest. Not that Mr. C from heaven isn't special, but I want to make sure we mention his big golf tournament coming up in Palm Springs. But joining us right now, a man that everybody's been talking about the last day. I was listening last night driving back from the hockey game, all the tributes to this guy from... And I'm thinking, wow, before SportsCenter, there was the George Michael Sports Machine. I know that. But before the George Michael Sports Machine, there was George Michael, the guy that I worked with when I was a young punk kid in Philly back at WFIL in 1970. And he made the announcement yesterday that he's leaving the legendary program that all the 30-something guys out there who grew up watching SportsCenter... Remember this before it, the George Michael Sports Machine. And George Michael joins us right now on the StubHub.com guest line. Down along the Beltway. How are you, George?
Tony, let me ask you, how have you not gotten fired yet? You go through jobs faster than I went through women.
I don't get fired. I quit. That's what happens. I quit before I can get fired, George.
Tony, I told you when I hired you in 1970, and I didn't hire you. I know that somebody else did, but I kind of helped you along.
Yes.
Tony, I told you, it doesn't pay to tell the boss to go to hell. Tony, the truth will set you free, but it will cost you your job.
Well, George, I heard the story last night, and I hear all these, and I keep saying young guys, but I can't believe, before there was SportsCenter, there was your, before, and again, we go back to WFIL Boss Jock days. I was a kid. George was the nighttime DJ there, and he helped me a lot as a young guy, and then he went to New York and did Islander game. People don't know about your Islander and your hockey history when you went to New York and then to D.C. and became the legend in D.C. that you've become in the national show with the Sports Machine, but it's been an unbelievable ride, George.
Tony, the fact is that, I had the good fortune from 1973 to 1975 to be the photographer for the Flyers. Those were the Broad Street Bully days. And I thought that would be the greatest thrill of my life. Then 1980, the Lake Placid Olympics, I was at ABC. You know, I was doing a show called Speaking of Sports. I filled in regularly for Howard Cosell. The whole time that I did the show, do you know that I worked for him for 5 years? In 5 years, Tony, he never once, not once in 5 years, did he ever say hello.
I'm shocked. I'm
ill of the dead, but for 5 years, for God's sakes, why couldn't you have said once hello? You know? And so to come and do the Sports Machine, let me say this. When I put in my first Earth Station, is what they used to be called, the little dishes you get for DirecTV, we used to have big mothers that ran $730,000 a piece. And I built four of those things in the parking lot here in Washington, and no one knew what I was doing. And I said, look, there's this little thing up in Bristol. It's a little thing called ESPN. No one will, it won't be big, but they've got a great idea with these satellites. So I put four of them in, and, God, now 27 years later, that's showbiz.
George, I love what I read is that you said, NBC's cutting back, and unfortunately our business is a lot about that. You told the folks, hey, if you're going to cut back and you're going to start getting rid of my people, I'm going to go. I want to go with my gang. Is that how it happened?
Tony, I'll make it very simple. I was offered just a tremendous deal. You know, we all work hoping that we're going to have a great payday. Man, my ship was coming in, but they wanted cutbacks, and I understand that. I don't respect it, but I understand it, and I accept it. And I said, look, if I've got to fire people that have been with me for 27, 24, 22 years, I said, then I got to be the first to go. And so what I did was I said, whatever money you were going to pay me, we're going to take care of everyone that's been working for me so they all get a really good going-away package. And I was able to do that. And, Bruno, you know me. I mean, nothing's changed. If you work with me, you and I are going to go together, and I don't care what it is. We're going together, and that's the way it is.
But why did you tell me this back in 1970 when we were working together at the old FIL days?
Ladies and gentlemen, here's something I should never talk about on the radio. But Tony Bruno's uncle was a friend of mine. Was his name Victor?
No, it was Angelo, and he wasn't my uncle.
Yes, it was. Now, listen to this, folks. I've just hired this guy, Tony Bruno. At the time, he had long hair. He looked like a reject from South Philadelphia. He comes in, and he's wearing, right on the first day, he's wearing a button because his uncle was in prison, and it says, Free Angelo from Prison. I said, Tony, you can't walk in with buttons trying to free the godfather from prison. That's going to intimidate people. And that's why no one in Philadelphia ever messed with Tony Bruno. They knew who his uncle was.
And the late, great Jack Hyland, the guy who hired me. But I was so fortunate to work with guys like you, George, when I was a kid growing up in this business. And I'm so proud of what you've done because I know you and I've known you for a long time. And I hear all these young guys paying tribute to you. And I say guys in their 30s are young guys. But, you know, all these guys who grew up in the 80s and 70s and college days, they know the George Michael sports machine before they knew SportsCenter, man. That's quite a tribute to be in that category.
It's a great thing to be able to do it. And, Tony, the nicest part is to have people say good things because, you know, you try to do it right. You do get into fights. You make some people angry, but you try to do it right. And, obviously, it hasn't been all bad. I mean, look, I've managed to stay friends with you. Of course, I have to because of your family relationships, but I like you.
So, George, we got to ask, what happens to the big button now?
I mean, I want that button so I can slam it here in the studio and start the tape machines.
Are you going to take the big button home with you?
The big button will rest. Hopefully, some folks at the Smithsonian asked if they could have it, and I said, hey, if it still works, it's all yours.
I hit buttons here. Nothing works here, George. I mean, at least your big button worked. Did it ever misfire?
Many times. There was the one time I said, roll, damn it. And then all of a sudden we go, oh, my God, he cursed on television. What are we going to do? Hey, you forget where we used to be in the 80s about the FCC. If you said hell or damn, you were going to both, baby.
Now if you say it, you're just a lame guy trying to do a talk show and trying to be like everybody else.
You got it, and it works that way. But it's been a great, you know, so many things have changed. But the one thing that's consistent is the equipment is never the way you want it to be.
Exactly. Hey, George, it's great to catch up with you. I'm so happy and proud for you, man. Good luck, and we'll see you. I saw you at the Super Bowl in Detroit, and hopefully we'll see you again down the road soon.
Super Bowl in Miami. Tony, have a great day on Sporting News Radio, brother. It's a pleasure.
Thank you, George. There he is, King George Michael. Wow. That's what I knew him as, King George Michael. I was a young, long-haired hippie freak. And he took me under his wings and turned me into the failure that I now am. How many years ago was that? 1970? Is that many years ago?
I don't know. For some strange reason, I'm having trouble picturing you with long hair. I don't know why.
So am I.
Yeah.
So am I. Meanwhile, let's go to our good friend Jim. Jim always has something good. And he joins us right now from the city that used to have hopes of winning some football games, but it's all over, Jim. Good morning.
Good morning, Tony. Friday, you had George Michael's on.
The great George Michael.
Stevens, the sports machine.
Remember the sports machine? Do you remember when George Michael and I worked on radio together in 1970?
You and me remember him as King George Michael.
Exactly right.
He was the number one DJ in Philadelphia because he beat the king before him. And I went back to my archives. I found some old classic tape of King George Michael.
Oh, Jim, you're the best.
When he was, he was the king of Philadelphia.
Let's go back to 1970, okay. What, 68, 69, 70? I'm talking old school. Love the King George. It's good to have him on, too.
George Michael! When you talk about great stuff, folks, I want you to get a little bit closer. If you've ever enjoyed a party, then you surely have had this along with you. Mitch Ryder, this song is dedicated to the devil. The devil with a blue dress on me.
Oh, man.
Now then, with that thought in mind, there is one Time in a Bottle by Jim Croce says it all, but there's one other song that for my life says it all, because every Friday night, it didn't matter where or when, whether it was FIL or ABC, this one song said everything for me. My feeling is, once you've gotten through Monday through Friday, you stand out in the middle of the Schuylkill Expressway and you say, hey woman, come get YOLO!
Oh man, I remember like it was yesterday.
There you go, Tony.
I love those days. At WFIL, famous 56 in Philly, which is now a car wash.
I think
like most
the
AM stations. Yeah. Like this place is going to be here in a couple of weeks in California.
I hope not.
Now, there's a car wash too close to here, although if they were going to make this place something, a car wash would be a good choice. That's good stuff, Jim. You remembered King Joy. King,
oh, he was
I
great.
Did the
he
news. I was the overnight. I was an 18-year-old punk kid, and I was doing the overnight news at WFIL, working from midnight to 8 a.m. And I used to just sit around there, and I did that for 7 years at that radio station, because that's how big of a station it was. That's how hard it was to. I was happy to be there, to work at that radio station, which at the time was one of the top radio stations in America.
Yeah, in 1971, I think they were the station of the year.
They were station of the year multiple times. And now look what's happened to this business. It's one big toilet.
You can say that again.
It's an outrage.
Today at 2 o'clock, they're going to announce the MVP of the National League. Who do you think will win, Tony?
Ryan Howard?
I hope so. It is an outrage. Yeah, outrage if we don't win.
If Ryan Howard doesn't win, what will the Eagle and Philly fans have to root for the rest of the year?
Well, the Phillies are number one team now in town. They're waiting
That's
for,
right.
for February 15th, pitchers and catchers.
Even that other one-trick pony station there in Philly, what are they going to talk about now?
I think they're in trouble.
What are they going to talk about? You can't call and bash the Eagles now. They're done.
Well, they can talk about Ryan Howard for today.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't worry about tomorrow.
The Eagle discussion for the future is over.
For the future is over, too. Thank you, Coach. Good job, Jim, as always. You're the best, Jim. That man has the greatest archive. The Smithsonian, the Museum of Radio and Television, doesn't have what this guy has. Do you realize that?
Do you picture the basement? Do you picture the basement with, like, kind
reel
of
the reels?
A damp, dripping water
somewhere?
Well,
that's all basements are like that.
And it just, and how big this thing is.
And when we met
be?
Jim, when we went to Philly a couple months ago, Jim is one of those guys, when you meet him, you know it's him. And I don't mean that in a disrespectful manner.
No.
You know, you meet a lot of listeners. People meet us for the first time, and they're like, wow, you don't look anything like you sound. Jim is, when you meet Jim, you say, I knew that was you, Jim. That's Jim. He's good.
When Jim got to within about 25 yards of us, and he hadn't said a word yet, I said, Tony, there's Jim.
Yep.
That's Jim.
Yo. And good news to report on this Tuesday, December 5th at this hour. Snoop Dogg was not arrested anywhere in and around the Los Angeles area last night. Because he was sitting at home watching Jeff Garcia get loose. And now your MVP candidate. I'm going to do like Cowboy fans with Tony Romo. I think the Eagles have found themselves a man who can take them to the playoffs. It is the greatness that is Jeff Garcia. Good morning, Mark Willett, on this Monday morning. Well, it's Tuesday. Is Monday over yet?
Yes, it is.
It's December 5th. It's the holiday season, and I've lost my mind.
Monday's over. Mr. Monday Night is done, and good morning to you, Tony Bruno.
Mr. Monday Night. I told you, and I picked against the Eagles. And I like all the emails, like, you don't know what you're doing.
It's become a tradition. When the Eagles play on Monday night,
I can't
night,
make picks when the Eagles are
of
on.
Of course you can.
See, because if I pick the Eagles, then I get all these, yeah, you're just a homer.
Doesn't matter.
So if I pick against them, it's like, you're just a jinx.
You know what you need to do, Tone?
What?
You need to just block all of that out and get it right. Because if you get it right, then everything that everybody was saying the next morning is just a bunch of junk.
It is.
You're not a homer if the pick is right. And both times that the Eagles have played at home on Monday night,
I went against them.
The Eagles were the pick.
Remember that Packer game? We were there.
And they were trailing at halftime.
And I said, see, I told you the Packers plus 12 was a good number.
And then it wasn't.
And then Brett Favre went out there and does what Brett Favre does. Loses the game and gets the number covered against him.
And that was when Lito Shepard wasn't even playing, the automatic interception maker at
he
the end
is.
Of a game.
Forget about Champ Bailey throwing. You throw the ball near the end zone near Champ Bailey, and he's going to get it picked off. Lito Shepard. You remember Drew Bledsoe? You remember that, Cowboy fans? Drew Bledsoe, Lito Shepard, gone the other way.
How did it feel, Drew?
Exactly right.
How did it feel? I tell you what, Lito Shepard's been in the end zone more than any Eagle all year long.
Exactly right. But Jeff Garcia last night, the boos coming down. Shocking that people would be booing Jeff Garcia. But he shook it off when he went out there, and he did a great job. And the Eagles now, all of a sudden, Bill Parcells can't say it anymore, country. Bill Parcells can no longer say the Eagle discussion for the season is over. Maybe next week he can if they can't beat the Washington Redskins.
The Eagle discussion for the future is over.
No, it's not, Bill. You worry about your stinking kicker making some more field goals before you come talking that garbage down this way, homeboy. You go down there and beat the Saints. Is that game in New Orleans or is that in Dallas?
No, that's a game in Dallas, Tony.
That's right. Say, Reggie Bush is on fire now.
Oh, yeah.
You think the Cowboys are going to be able to stop Reggie Bush? No, they're not.
Yes.
No, they're not.
Yes, I do think they are.
Why would they be able to stop Reggie Bush?
Because he's been stopped 11 times out of 12 games.
He's hitting his stride just like Jeff Garcia. Reggie Bush is in stride right now.
The only team that didn't stop him is like the worst defense in the history of mankind and creation. But other than that, yeah, you're right. Reggie Bush is going to go crazy again.
Joe Theismann will join us this hour. We'll talk about that Monday night game. It started out as a stinker. I mean, it was a punt fest, and then all of a sudden, it's 24-24 late in the game. It was a game that really looked ugly, but it turned out to be entertaining, even if you're not a Cowboy or a Carolina fan or an Eagle fan. That was fun to watch. Joe Theismann will join us. You got all kinds of good stuff, too. We'll take your calls at 888-441-TONY, 888-441-8669. You can email Tony at sportingnews.com. Mark with a K at sportingnews.com. We're taking holiday requests, too. Ever since I mentioned Andy Williams and limoncello shots last hour, we're getting, oh, we have Andy on the line? Andy Williams on the line? Does he have his white turtleneck on?
Hello, Tony. Happy holiday. Happy holiday. Happy holiday. Happy holiday. It smells. Keep ringing. Happy holidays to you. It's
the holidays. Have you had any limoncello this morning, Andy, on your way into...
Hello, dee-doo. A hickory dock. Don't forget.
It is anyway.
2 o'clock and Santa's coming. 12 o'clock. He'll be coming on the Christmas time.
I hope not.
What about it?
Oh, man. Yes, Andy.
No, it's Richie in Oakland.
Oh, Richie, you can sing. You're a good Andy Williams. You're a terrible Rich Lieberman, but you're a good Andy Williams.
Yeah, I know. I stayed away. I was in Vegas, baby. But I just had to do that for you because I heard you like Andy.
Well, I love that song. Do we have that song? Give me a taste, country. Now, that was the fake Andy Williams. This
we're
is the real.
All fake things on this show, though.
Yeah,
so
it's
that's
fake.
Okay.
We're in LA. Everything's fake here. There we go. This, how great is this song?
It's the holiday season. And Santa Claus has got a toy for every good girl and good little boy. Santa's a great big bundle of joy.
Here he's coming down the chimney down. Everybody now.
He'll have a big fat pack upon his back.
So will Snoop will have a big backpack. And the Carmelo Anthony
Carmelo
will have a
Anthony,
backpack.
Sure.
And everybody's
Damon Stoudemire. Yeah, we go through the whole league if you want. I mean...
See what Jeff Garcia does for the holiday season? He puts everybody in that swell mood again.
Yeah, you know, and I was wondering when the holiday spirit was going to take over, too, because, you know, everyone's supposed to be nice to each other. I wasn't feeling it yet. We're 20 days away from Christmas, and I'm still getting flipped up on the roads like normal.
Oh, man.
But now that Jeff Garcia has learned how to find a wide receiver downfield again, the world is right. Everything is green and red.
When Keyshawn Johnson's throwing his helmet in the last 20 seconds of the game, you know the world once is again right. Is a yeah. better place.
And a safe place.
Yes, it is. God bless Jeff Garcia.
And God bless the official for not calling pass.
It wasn't bad. Well, Joe Theismann will join us this hour. Dear Tony, will you please play I'll Be Home for Christmas for me? Sincerely, Larry Coker. No, actually, Larry's got to coach one more stinking bowl game, right?
Yes, he
which
got,
one is that Miami's
he's
in?
He's got to go up to the blue Smurf turf.
Oh, that's right, in Boise.
In Boise on, I believe, I want to say it's December 29th, December 30th, something like that.
I don't know. Just wake me up. I'll be home for the holidays for that one.
It is no longer called the Humanitarian Bowl, Tony.
Why? Well, because if Miami's in it, can it be a Humanitarian Bowl?
No, it is now called the MPC Computers Bowl. And, of course, all the players were excited.
Is that New Year's Eve?
It's New Year's Eve.
I said I wasn't going to mention bowl games.
MPC Computers Bowl, Tony, and they're all going there because all the players think they'll get to steal a free computer on the way out the door, win or lose.
They probably will.
And they will.
Let's go to Joe. He was at the link last night feeling the greatness that is Jeff Garcia. Joe, you feeling me?
I'm feeling it, Tony, but if I hear that song one more time, I'm going to throw up my strap.
If I play that song one more time, you know what's going to happen, don't you?
What's that?
What's his name's going to throw up? He didn't throw up last night. Our good friend Steve Smith did not throw up at the link.
Tony, they were brutal on Garcia, the fans.
I agree. I thought it was wrong. I mean,
they were chanting all.
You know, A.J. Feely, I know he did a nice job a few years ago when he came in as the third quarterback after McNabb got hurt and then Coy Detmer got hurt. But why? I mean, I know they do that in all towns when they want the backup quarterback. Give Jeff Garcia a chance. And all of a sudden now, do those people want A.J. Feely now?
No. They were.
booing. They were calling them names the whole game. It was, they just didn't want them in there.
It's an outrage.
I couldn't figure it out. But I had the unfortunate situation to sit next to a bus trip of Carolina Panther fans.
No way.
Brutal. We came within 10 seconds of getting thrown out of there last night.
Was there almost threats of physical violence, much like I threatened Dallas Cowboy fans?
Real bad, yeah. Terrible.
Joe, when the game was over, did you look at all of them and ask them?
I don't remember.
How does it feel?
I don't remember.
Did you have any limoncello with you last night?
Man, we were there from noon on.
Oh, that's a good thing.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's a good football.
I don't remember the fourth quarter.
I do. I remember Keyshawn Johnson. That helmet's still rolling down the field right now. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing.
It was a good game. So, from what I understand, they won.
From what? There you go. And you made it home safely, Joe. That's the best thing.
Yeah.
Good job. Did you drive?
No.
See, that's the kind of, that's a good fan right
that
there.
Is.
He knows when to say, "Get out of my face, Carolina Panther fan." I want to thank Savannah Sampson. Brian Billick, who wasn't quite as loquacious as Savannah earlier, even though he won Monday Night Football 48-3.
You want Billick to talk dirty, do you?
Yeah. Ed Cunningham of ABC, Michael Bradley of the Sporting News, Harry Gallis, Bob Hilly of Sporting News, and Dr. Sample of USC, as Matt Leiner got the Sportsman of the Year award on the show earlier.
Tony and everybody who listens, have a great holiday.
You too.
Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa.
All
happy New
stuff.
Year. Good night. Drive carefully. God bless America and God bless Savannah Sampson. It's a beautiful country.
I need a vacation.
Sporting News Radio.